बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, आई एम डॉक्टर शहजाद लतीफ़, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर ऑफ गैस्ट्रोएंटरोलॉजी, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मेडिसिन। टुडेज आवर लेक्चर ऑफ थर्ड ईयर एमबीबीएस इज अ एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ मोटर सिस्टम एंड स्पीच। इन दिस segment we will discuss only motor system and speech. Rest of other examination, sensory, gait, we will discuss inshallah in the next lecture. Hopefully there are 3 or 4 lectures remaining. Today is the 4th lecture of regarding CNS. So don't be afraid of any CNS examination. It's a very dramatic, very systemic examination. If you will focus over your system examination, it's very, very like mathematical calculating type of the system examination. So if you start, it's a mathematically point of view, then it will help you a lot. We'll do as a like the fingertips. Just remember some points, some tricks, and then you will do like as you will do on fingertips. So it's very important first step. Never ever afraid of CNS examination. Moreover, it's a motor examination is a very important system, because your final examination of the MBBS final year never ever complete without examination of central nervous system. Because in short case, in long case, some short commands, examiner may ask you examination of lower limb, examination of upper limb, examination of sensory system, examination of gait, cranial nerve examination in 1 or 2 minutes command. So it's very important to focus on CNS examination. Once you will learn CNS examination and you will perform with confident, I'm not saying that with accuracy, but with confident, if you will perform your CNS examination command, no examiner will never ever give you low grade or fail even, and always give an excellent impression over the examiner. So it's very important, take little bit focus over your CNS examination. Now we will start one by one over the examination of motor system. If you will recall your background knowledge of physiology and anatomy, especially neuroanatomy, you will remember your diagram of motorway pathway. It's very important, because without some knowledge of neuroanatomy and physiology, little bit difficult to assess where is lesion, what type of the lesion, and which organ is involved. So it's important to recall or remember your neuroanatomy and physiology. If you will focus in this diagram, you will see a dotted line of upper motor neuron and straight line is a lower motor neuron in this diagram. If you see this in dotted line, start from the cortex of the cerebrum, then it will move to the spinal cord, and from spinal cord it will start a straight line in a black color. It will give a it is a basically lower motor neuron. If you will observe, this is a end organ, like muscles of tongue and hair, end or start of the motor neuron, then it will up the neuromuscular junction in the spinal cord, and from spinal cord to motor to the cortex is the dotted line is called, is a showing here is a track of upper motor neuron. So it's very important to know this, because you have to assess is their lesion is upper motor neuron lesion or the lower motor neuron lesion. This is a very important examination of motor system. Importance of upper motor neuron, lower motor neuron. There are some type of some MCQs, maybe SCQ or even Viva question. Examiner may ask what and where is exact anatomical location of the upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron, or how will you differentiate motor neuron from upper motor neuron from the lower motor neuron. So it's a very common Viva question. It should be clear every students about it. Structure and function, as you everybody know very well about the, you know, neuroanatomy and physiology. Just we will recall here a pathway of CNS. It included in the cross presentation, sensory pathway, motor pathway, upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron. If you will more describe in little bit, two tracks, sensory pathway, spinal thalamic track, posterior dorsal column track, motor pathways, corticospinal or pyramidal track, extra pyramidal track, cerebellar system, etc. If you just recall your neuroanatomy, very easy. You are very much familiar about all these terminology. Here, just we are recalling your knowledge of neuroanatomy and neurophysiology. Upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron already discussed. In this diagram, just want to explain, if you in a diagrammatic way, if you assume this is a cortex of the brain, motor part of the cortex, from motor part of the cortex start the upper motor neuron. It's a red color is of upper motor neuron. Upper motor neuron and in spinal cord, at it is called neuromuscular. If you will focus on the cursor, you will see neuromuscular junction of upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron. In the blue color, it's a lower motor neuron. It will be from neuromuscular junction, usually in the spinal cord, then up to the target organ like muscles, whatever the body, wherever the body is, lower motor neuron. Going from this neuromuscular junctions from spinal cord to the muscle. So this is the just like a diagrammatic way to explain the upper motor neuron, lower motor neuron and its a distribution pathway. Upper motor neuron basically is a cell body within motor cortex, prefrontal, usually prefrontal gyrus. Now we are explaining upper motor neuron. And axon terminate cranial nerve, motor nucleus, corticobulbar, anterior horn of the spinal cord or corticospinal. If we will move toward the backslide and focus on the cursor, this is the neuromuscular junction, is the anterior horn of the spinal cord, where we say we are discussing in the next slide, anterior horn of the spinal cord is a corticospinal. So corticospinal area is this is the corticospinal area. So very easy to know about this physiology. Now moving towards the lower motor neuron, is a cell body of motor cranial nerve nucleus, anterior horn cell, again that shown in the previous one picture, axon terminate, motor end plate, is the skeletal muscle. Moving toward back, this is the end plate and up in the muscle. And this is the track of the lower motor neuron. So this is basically explanation of very short and very brief explanation of upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron. Of course, it's very important for all the theory examination and Viva examination. Sometimes teacher or examiner asking your Viva, how will you differentiate upper motor neuron from the lower motor neuron? Upper motor neuron? What is lower motor neuron? So important for every student at least to differentiate upper motor from lower motor neuron. Now moving toward your basic clinical approach to the patient of any weakness. So systemic approach of to weakness of any part of the body, you must differentiate where is the pathology, what is the pathology and which type of the pathology. Number one, muscles, Is there any involvement of muscle, neuromuscular junction, nerve, and which nerve root, and where it is? It spinal cord or brain stem or cerebrum? So for assessing a patient having a weakness of any part of the body, weakness of left side of the body, or weakness of right side of the body, or weakness single upper limb, weakness any single lower limb, or any paresis or paralysis of your facial nerve. So you must assess the which neuron involvement. Is it upper motor neuron or lower motor neuron? Is there just muscular involvement or neuromuscular junction, nerve tract involvement, nerve root involvement? Is there lesion in spinal cord, brain stem, or cerebrum? It's very important. If you become a master assessing approaching in this way, a patient presenting with weakness, it's not very difficult. It's very easy. Just recall your all these steps, you may easily assess where is the pathology. So you may easily pick up the finding, and you may easily make up the diagnosis where is the lesion located. So it's a diagrammatic picture of like you may say, it's a how will you differentiate upper motor neuron from the lower motor neuron. If you will inspect the muscle, on inspection, if upper motor neuron lesion, then it may be normal. If atrophy, that may be not due to upper motor neuron, that may be due to disuse or immobility of that specific muscle may develop atrophy. Otherwise, if lower motor neuron, it may be atrophic muscle, there may be presence of fasciculation. If you will assess tone, for you people, for third year people, third year students, very little bit difficult for this step. Of course, it is a domain of clinical examination where you will, inshallah, where we will pass over this pandemic, COVID-19, and will start clinical examination bedside, the hospital and ward. Of course, you will know how will you check the tone, how will you inspect the muscle, how will you check the power. It's classical bedside real-time patient examination method, tendon reflexes, pathological reflexes. These all part will discuss in bedside over the real-time patient. If you will assess the tone in upper motor neuron, it will always increase unless acute. In acute patient, it may be decreased, it may be normal. In lower motor neuron lesion, it will always decreased, but in some time, it may be normal. Grossly, it will decrease. Power, if there is upper motor neuron lesion, power always be decreased. Of course, in lower motor neuron, same may be happen. And if there is, if you will assess reflexes in upper motor neuron, always it will be brisk or increased. And in lower motor neuron, it may be normal or it may be decreased. Pathological reflexes always present in upper motor neuron lesion, but it may be absent in lower motor neuron lesion. There are some way to assess the reflexes in the motor system. Now we will discuss one by one all the reflexes in the upper limb and lower limb as well. Before going to reflexes, you must know about the for assessing motor system patient, you must know five step. Is number one is how is the condition of muscle, I mean bulk of the muscle. Number two, fasciculation. Number three, tone. Number four, power. Number five is this is reflexes. The number one is bulk. Gross inspection, you will assess grossly, is there any atrophic, hypertrophied muscle mass, or you will measure same muscle over the both side of the upper limb or lower limb. Is there any difference between muscle mass or bulk? you will assess by using measuring tape or just your finger or hand to pick the equal place. Is there any difference between bulk and tone? Of course, it's on theoretical or verbally, it's very difficult to explain it. But when you will move in the ward, you will assess by moving the limbs of the body of the patient like this. And then, if you will do it multiple times in the ward for the patient, you may easily pick up is it increased or decreased. Because if you will do all the clinical method in the real time in the patient, you may know easily what is the normal tone. If you know the normal tone, then you can easily pick the tone is increased or tone is decreased. And third one is power. Power is always in a grade 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. If patient easily can move to and fro, up and down without any against the resistance and with passive movement as well, then power is 5/5. If patient unable to move against the resistance, then it will be power 4/5. If patient cannot stay or cannot move against the gravity, then it will be 3/5. If patient cannot, in addition to previous one, if cannot patient move to and fro, then it will be 2/5. If patient move just flickering or withdrawing the limb toward the stimulus, then it will be 1/5. In addition to the previous one. And of course, if patient unable to move with painful stimulus with command, it will be 0/5. And last one is of reflexes. There are some deep reflexes, there are some superficial reflexes. No will move toward deep tendon reflexes in the upper limb. If you will focus in this slide, in this picture, you will observe in picture 1, just assessing the bicep reflexes. You will put your thumb over the tendon of the bicep in the median cubital fossa and hit hammer directly, not to the tendon. Actually, it is hitting over your thumb, and by hitting hammer to your thumb, you will assess there some movement over the bicep. If you will do normal in patient, you may easily pick is it increase, is it decrease, absent. Of course, if there is nothing, then it will be absent. But increasing reflexes or decrease or brisk reflexes or diminished reflexes, it will be assessed only by examination the multiple time of the multiple patient. So it's very important real time examination of the patient. So anyway, this is the proper way to assess the bicep reflexes. And if you focus on the second figure, picture B, it's the triceps reflexes. Holding hand of the patient, you will hit over the epitrochlear fossa, medial to epitrochlear fossa. There is a tendon of the tricep muscle, and you will hit over that tendon. If there is movement in the region of the triceps, then it will give you information regarding status of the that reflex. Is it absent, diminished, or brisk reflex? And in third picture showing spinator jerk, it's a brachioradialis muscle assessing. Or again, over the radial spectrum of the hand, there is tendon of the brachioradialis muscle. You will hit over that tendon. If there is any twitching or movement over the muscle, then easily assess the is it increased, decreased, diminished, or absent. And in the next slide, you will assess the again reflexes of the fingers muscle. Again, putting your hand over the palmar aspect of the finger and hitting hammer to your hand. If there is reflexes, you will assess again increase, decrease, diminished, absent. This is the somewhere some examiner's favorite question: Hoffman sign. What is the Hoffman sign? Because in some viva, some teachers' favorite question. So it's very important for a student to know how to check this and what is this. In this, basically, it is the Babinski of upper limb. If examiner asks you check the Babinski of the upper limb, it's very strange for you, as Babinski is always in the lower limb. But if you will assess the plantar in the upper limb, then you will do this again, holding finger, one finger of the patient in your hand, and suddenly you will withdraw by fixing your finger in the patient hand. If there is any like movement, if it is withdrawing, then it's a normal. If patient's static or statue, nothing movement, then it's a positive sign. So it's a very, if there is, like, in short you may say clonus, then it's Babinski positive. If not, then it's Babinski negative. Now moving toward the reflexes of the lower limb. In again this figure, you easily may pick the knee jerk, and second one is the ankle jerk. In picture A, you will hold lower limb of the patient, and by assessing tuberosity, above the tuberosity, you will notice there is tendon. By palpating that specific tendon, you will hit your hammer over that tendon and focus your eye over the anterior aspect of the thigh. And by hitting that tendon, you will easily pick is it diminished, absent, or brisk reflexive. And in knee jerk, same, not too much flex, not too much extend. You will put the hammer over the Achilles tendon and check the muscle reflexes over the belly of the calf muscle. Again, by multiple examination, you may easily pick the reflexes absent, diminished, brisk, or absent. So this is the way to assess the deep reflexes, deep tendon reflexes actually. If you observe it is not conclusive or not giving proper information, then you may reinforce the patient. You may say the patient clench your teeth, or you may hold this your hand like this. By saying this, patient tension will be diverted to that specific command which you order him, clench your teeth or fix your hand bones. Then easily may you assess the ankle or knee jerk. Plantar reflex or Babinski reflex is a superficial reflex. You will do it by over the arc of the foot, lateral aspect. And this figure also is easily visible. You may follow the scroll. You will start putting not a very sharp, not a very blunt instrument. Preferably it should be used like key, any key. You must have a key. You will start like scratching over the lateral aspect of the arc and move toward upward over the, then we make a arc toward big toe. This is the proper way. This is the proper way to assess the Babinski reflex or plantar reflex of the lower limb. So this is the proper way. If it is down going, it means Babinski negative. If it is up going, it means Babinski positive. Normally Babinski is negative, but in disease, in upper motor neural lesion, it is always positive. Abdominal reflex, again it's a example of superficial reflexes. You will assess this reflex by exposing abdomen and rectus abdominal muscle, using again your key or very blunt end of your hammer stick. just striking your key over this aspect, and then this aspect, four quadrant around the umbilicus or over the rectus abdominis. If by scratching over this muscle, patient squeeze the muscle, it means there is positive abdominal reflex. If unable, then it means it may be absent. Moving toward the next part of our lecture is speech and handedness. All right-handed and 40% of left-handed person have left hemisphere dominance for speech, because there is some dominance sphere. There are two, right or left. Always most common is the right hemisphere. Even in the left-handed person, 40% have right-handed dominant hemisphere. And in speech defect, you will observe dysphasia, like any impaired language. It means there is cortical lesion. Expressive mean if broca area, patient can empty comprehend, cannot speak, but can speak, but follow the command. In receptive, Wernicke, patient can speak but cannot comprehend, and conduction. Dysphonia is impaired voice production, like vocal cord deformity, and dysarthria, impaired articulation. Patient can speak, but there is broken words or broken sentence. Tongue twisting is again and maybe example. There are some way to assess the speech. How will you assess the speech? You may ask the patient some word to speak, and then you will assess the understanding. If patient can easily understand, follow 2 to 3 step of the command. Show me your tongue, close your eye. You may ask like this type of a question. Close your eye, touch left ear with right hand. If patient obey, it means he is understanding properly. And stand up, close the door. Speech for fluency, and is it meaningful or with grammar? You will assess speech of the patient. Repetition, you will say patient some sentence to repeat, assess. It is the proper again way of assessing the speech. Naming, patient can easily name the patient object, watch, pen, keys, or phone, etc. So it's again way to assess the speech. Reading, patient can read sentence or identify the picture. It's a proper way to assess the speech. Writing, can write a meaningful sentence or it's a broken. If you will assess an algorithm, follow this algorithm, you may easily assess patient if is a deaf, or there is some pathology or global aphasia, Wernicke aphasia, or broca aphasia. If patient can he hear? If no, then it means he is a deaf. If he can hear, does he understand? No. Does he speak fluently? No. It means global aphasia. But if patient can speak fluently, then you will ask, can he repeat? If no, it means Wernicke aphasia. If patient can, it means transcortical sensory aphasia. So if patient, moving towards again first limb, does he understand? Yes. Does he speak fluently and use words correctly? No. Can he repeat? No. It means broca aphasia. If yes, then transcortical motor aphasia. If patient can speak fluently and use word correctly, yes. Can he repeat? If no, then conduction aphasia. If yes, can he name object? No. Nominal aphasia. If yes, then it means it's all step of speech are normal speech. So this is the very 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 short and brief explanation of the speech. If you remember this algorithm, or you may easily pick the status of speech of the patient, because in the examination of CNS system, it's a very important to assess the status of the speech of the patient. It is again some mandatory to at least memorize this algorithm for a good examination of central nervous system. If you people have any question regarding motor system examination or examination of the speech, you may easily may ask me any question. You may anytime message me over the WhatsApp or even may call, and attendance will be marked over the WhatsApp group. Thank you very much.